The gentleman's time is up. Mr. George Galloway.
Back in the days, Madam Deputy Speaker, when I was his warm-up act, I used to describe the Right Honourable Member for Manchester Gorton as the best Foreign Secretary we never had. And his speech this evening showed why. Indeed, an alternative administration of all the talents became clear on the other side in the debate, with his friends from Holborn, St Pancras, from Islington, from Liverpool, Walton. How much stronger the Labour Party's position would be in the opinion polls today if those were the men sitting around the Cabinet table rather than those men and women who are. And what a contrast, those shafts of light, with the myopia displayed by the Foreign Secretary. So rose-tinted were her glasses, she had even spotted the first election in Saudi Arabia. Well, as someone who follows events in the Arab world closely, I have to tell you I had missed the first elections in Saudi Arabia, probably the unfreest, most undemocratic, anti-democratic country on the earth. So keen was she to describe the success of Anglo-American policy in the Arab world, she prayed and aid a grant to the youth parliament in Bahrain. But these were not the most foolish of the things that she said in her long speech today. She talked about supporting the government and people of the Lebanon. Well, let's split that proposition. She wasn't much help to the government of the Lebanon when its Prime Minister was weeping on television, begging for a ceasefire, when the British and American governments alone in the world were refusing and indeed blocking any attempts to demand an immediate ceasefire of the Israeli bombardment. Worse, she wasn't much help to the government or the people of the Lebanon when British airports were being used for the transshipment of American weapons to Israel that were raining down death and destruction on the very people of Lebanon she now says she stands beside. But of course that was code for saying she does not support the 1 million demonstrators in the square in Beirut who are demanding democracy. She describes the government of the Lebanon as a democratic government. If the minister will listen, I can educate him. There is no democratic government in the Lebanon. He should know this. If there was a democracy in Lebanon, Hassan Nasrallah would be the president because he would get most votes. But of course he can't be the president because you have to be a Christian to be the president and you have to be a Sunni to be the prime minister and you have to be a Shiite to be the speaker. It's precisely the opposite of democracy they have in Lebanon. It's a sectarian building block government they have in the Lebanon, and moreover, one which is based on a census more than 50 years out of date. If the 1 million demonstrators had been in the Ukraine, or the Belarus, or Georgia, they'd be being described as the Orange Revolution, or some other epithet, perhaps the Cedar Revolution, even. So myopic was the Foreign Secretary. She talked about the peace process in Palestine, refused to condemn the theft, as the member for Manchester Gorton put it. He used the words of $900 million stolen from the Palestinian Authority. The member for Liverpool, Wavertree, advanced the extraordinary proposition without a hint of irony that we're fighting for democracy in Iraq whilst we can steal the money of the Palestinian administration in the occupied territories because the people voted for a government that Olmert, Bush and Blair didn't like. So myopic was the Foreign Secretary's view that she prayed in aid an opinion poll from Basra which told us that the people had every confidence in the police. That's the same police. We had to send the British government in to blow up a police station and kill umpteen Iraqi policemen because we said they were about to massacre the prisoners in their jails. She prayed and aid the Iraqi government, a virtual government, as saying, even the Iraqi government, more importantly, the Iraqi government, do not consider that they have a civil war. Of course they don't. Because there is no Iraqi government. As the member for Manchester Gorton put it, we've installed a gang of warlords in power in Baghdad. The heads of competing militias, some of them at war with our own soldiers in the south of Iraq. It's not a government, Madam Deputy Speaker, it's Martin Scorsese's gangs of New York that we've put in charge in Baghdad. And that's not my concept, that's the member for Manchester Gorton's concept. So myopic. She had her finger out and wagging at Iran, warning Iran of what it must do or must not do in terms of nuclear weapons. When she's the foreign secretary of a government about to spend £75 billion on our own nuclear weapons, a government that declares itself the best friend of Israel, which has hundreds of nuclear weapons and refuses to sign the non-proliferation treaty, which says nothing about Pakistan, a military dictatorship acquiring nuclear weapons. It would make you laugh if it didn't make you cry. But most serious of all was the extent to which she sought to lull us to sleepwalk into a coming conflict with Iran. Invited by one of our colleagues to describe, as the former Foreign Secretary had, an attack on Iran as inconceivable, she refused, preferring instead the formulation that no one is contemplating it. But they are contemplating it. Israel has a war plan carefully worked out to do it. American generals, as we know from the journalism of Seymour Hersh, the greatest of all American journalists who brought us the stories from Vietnam, have to the nth degree worked out an attack upon Iran. She says that we stand by our soldiers. We stand by them so much. We pay them so little. We had to give them a Christmas bonus to make up their wages. Their families are claiming means-tested benefits. Their families are living in houses you wouldn't put a dangerous dog in. We send them ill-clad, ill-equipped, ill-armed, without armour, on a pack of lies into war after war after war. But let me invite the House to contemplate this and see if I'm as right about this as I was about Iraq 4 years ago. If a finger is raised against Iran by Israel or the United States, the first people to pay the price will be the 7,000 young men and women of the British Armed Forces that we have stationed in the south of Iraq, where Iran, thanks to us, is now top dog. If you want to know what that will look like, think about the film Zulu, but without the happy ending. That's how irresponsible our government is. They're part of an axis which is contemplating a war against a country we have made powerful in a place where we have our soldiers standing in a thin red line in the sand. Madam Deputy Speaker, for the moment, the trial of Tony Blair merely takes place on Channel 4 television. The day will come, and it's coming soon, when a real trial of Tony Blair will take place in a real court.
Well, member knows he must refer to members by their constituency or their office.